the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
A warm welcome to you tonight to this memorial service. I'm Diane. A warm welcome from Reverend Gordon Cooper and Reverend Bob as well. During the service, there'll be an opportunity for you to come forward and light a candle and during that time, we will be reading out the names of your loved ones. So if you haven't already, check the names there on the list, and please do so during the first hymn in a moment. All the words that you need for the service are in the order of service. Please join in with all the words that are involved. And just to mention a few things, we're not having refreshments tonight, but on the back of your order of service, it mentions about our Share and Care Cafe. This is just a monthly, just coming along just to share for anybody who's lonely or dealing with bereavement or loss. That's starting on the first Wednesday of the month, and that's starting in December, and that's 10:31 to 1. If you'd like to have an entry in our Book of Remembrance, then just have a word with me at the end of the service, and I can put you in touch with Susan, who deals with that. And the Book of Remembrance in church, we remember those people when their year's mind comes round every year, and we remember them in our prayers on Wednesday and on a Sunday. When the service is finished, please stay as long as you wish. If you want to get straight off, that's fine. If you want to sit a bit longer, then please do. And use this space for whatever you, how you ever want, really, at the end. We're here to do some very important things together. We're here to remember our loved ones who've died, to hear their name called out, and for a candle to be lit in their memory, and to remember them with love. We have in common the fact that we are all bereaved. And this might be a recent bereavement, or we might have been bereaved for quite some time, or somewhere in between. We're all on a journey along the path of grief, and our journey is very unique to us. Wherever we are on that journey, there's no right or wrong way to be dealing with it. For some, that means talking about their loved one. For some, it's the complete opposite. Each bereaved person deals with grief very, very differently. Part of the journey is to recognise the way that we grieve is okay for us if it helps us to cope. We all grieve very differently, and that may be very much affected by the age of the person who died and or the way our loved one died. Your loved one's death may have been expected. You may have had time to plan and come to terms with it, or it might have been the complete opposite, unexpected, completely out of the blue. It may have been during the pandemic. It may have been due to COVID. You may have had to deal with not seeing them before they died. You might have had to deal with the severe COVID restrictions in the numbers at their funeral, with people being unable to attend, and the funeral being very different from the one you would have wanted them to have. Each way will still have been a shock. So tonight, we want to bring all of that into God's hands. We will be reading out our loved ones' names and be lighting a candle in their memory. And whilst you light the candle, you might want to think of the following things that the candle can represent. It can represent your loved one, the memories that you share. It can represent your grief for your loved one. It can represent your courage to confront your sorrow and to be comforted. And it can represent your shared love for that person. So let's turn to our opening prayers. Please join in as I say with the words involved. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. The eternal God is our dwelling place, and underneath are his everlasting arms. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore can I lack nothing. Loving God, with you, we rejoiced in our loved one's life, their kindness, their laughter, their strength. Today we remember them before you. Speak to us your words of comfort and assurance. Amen. So if you're able to please stand for our first hymn, The Day Thou Gavest, Lord, is ended.
Two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. And then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word, before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they indeed had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things, then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted them the things about himself and all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead to see what were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening. The day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening up the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had made known to them in the breaking of bread. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
We just read out Psalm 121. The sounds of the poems of the Bible, they speak of every single human emotion and how God's people in the past and now in the present speak to God. This one we're now going to be singing is Psalm 23, which speaks about God being our shepherd, being with us through life and through death. So we're going to sing this. This is our second hymn. So please stand if you're able to.
Thank you.
Jesus' death, his burial, and the story of the empty tomb, where two men in dazzling clothes told the women who went to the tomb that Jesus was risen. And these same women rushed back to tell Jesus' friends the news of his resurrection. This is then when our reading comes in. And two of these friends are walking to a village called Emmaus and discussing all the events. They're grieving for Jesus. They're mourning him. They're trying to understand the truth about his missing body and the story of the resurrection. And they're on a journey, walking about 7 miles, and they're trying to understand what's happened. We are all in the same boat as them. We're on our own journey, our journey of bereavement, and we're here together tonight, like Jesus' two friends in the story, to remember someone we love who's died. Tonight we will hear their name and be able to light a candle and to remember them. We have in common a journey of bereavement. And for some of us, we may have just set off on that journey. For others, we may have been on the journey longer. The length of time may vary for all of us, but we're on that journey together. Journeys can be a lot better when they're shared. And there are people who travel with us on our journey. The main person on our journey with us is the person who's died, their memory, sitting in our hearts, our mind, our soul, never leaving us, no matter the length of journey. Our love for them is with us forever. And there are others on this journey with us. As we heard in the story, these two friends are walking together, discussing together, but then joined by the risen Lord Jesus, though they do not yet know it's him. And he says to them, what are you discussing with each other while you walk along? They stood still looking sad. And they told him about Jesus' death and the story of his empty tomb. They shared their memory of the person they loved with him. Isn't that so important for us all as well? To have the opportunity to share our bereavement journey with others. To talk about our loved one. That's an essential part of our bereavement and the grieving process, to be able to talk about them and mention them by name. And to have another person listen to us is really important, especially as time lengthens and there are less opportunities for talking about them. Jesus recognises this with the two friends, their sadness and bereavement, and he lets them talk and listens. Who is on our journey with us? Do we have people, family and friends and others who will let us talk about our bereavement, our grief? Or who will just listen? People to share our story with, who can journey with us for companionship and support and care. I hope we have those people. They are God's sign to us that he is with us also on this journey. We always have God to talk to. God is always there to listen. In our story, it tells us that Jesus went and searched the two friends out on their journey. He went to them. It took a while for the two friends to realise it was Jesus with them, but they did eventually have a sense of him. And the men get to the village of Emmaus and urge Jesus strongly, saying, stay with us, because it's almost evening and the day is now nearly over. They asked him to stay with them. He did stay with them. And over bread, he opened their eyes to see who he was. They saw the hope of the resurrection, that new life. And they were given a sense of God's presence with them, which gave them hope. That sense of the risen Lord. He helped them on their journey of bereavement. Again, what about us? Well, God searches us out and walks with us on our journey. And sometimes we may not be able to acknowledge him or sense him, but he is there. God is with us on our journey. We might not recognise him, but he may be in the people around us who are caring for us and loving us. He may be in the stranger who speaks to us and acknowledges our hurts and our pain. He's there on the journey with us, just waiting for an opportunity where we can recognise that he's on the journey with us. This story encourages us to ask God, through Jesus, to stay with us a while. Which he will.
And then you can help us see God's love for us in the pain and the sorrow, and feel and sense God's healing touch on our journey. On journeys, we sometimes stop and rest, we pause, we reflect. On physical journeys, we sometimes have a bench that we stop at and rest. I want you to picture an image of sitting on a bench on your journey of bereavement, your mourning bench. To pause a while, and like the friends in the story who asked Jesus to stay with them, for us to ask Jesus to come and sit beside us on our mourning bench. Because he will sit with us for as long as we need. He will give us his listening ear, his comfort, his love, his hope, for as long as we need. I'm going to read out a poem written by someone's experience of asking Jesus to come and sit with them on their mourning bench and how it helps them over their journey of bereavement. It's called Come Sit Beside Me on My Mourning Bench. Sit with me, Lord Jesus, sit with me a while. Tell me it will be all right, that I will learn to smile again eventually, sometime. Sit with me, Lord Jesus, sit with me a while. Hold my hand through this pain. Hold my hand so I may gain some strength to walk this mile. Sit with me, Lord Jesus, sit with me for a while. Wipe my tears as they fall. Wipe my tears, now shown to all. The pain inside cannot be hidden. Sit with me, Lord Jesus, sit with me a while. Say nothing, just be. Say nothing, just stay with me. Say nothing, just cry with me. You sat with me, Lord Jesus. You sat with me a while. You held my hand, you stroked my brow. You caught the tears that fell. You loved me, you comforted me. You eased my tears, you eased my pain, and you helped me smile again in time. And you still sit with me, Lord Jesus. You still sit with me a while. We reminisce, we remember the memories of all that is past. And together we look ahead, we plan, we talk, we laugh, we cry all mixed together. Because that is what life is, laughing and crying, pain and joy. But always with you beside me, sitting with me a while. Jesus joins us on our journey of bereavement and is there forever, pointing us to God's love for us. So whilst on your journey, I invite you to ask him to come and sit with you on your mourning bench as you journey on with him into the future together. Amen. Well, let's stand to sing our next hymn, which is Lord, Lord, Help Us.
Thank you.
So if you want to listen out for your loved one's name, and then if you wish, please come out. We'll pass you a taper to light the candle. And then can I ask you to come to light the candle? Could you come down the aisle and then go that way? And I know you might have to walk ahead, but that's just to avoid us all walking into each other. And there may be somebody at the top there that will probably ask you to sanitise your hands as well. Sorry to be very practical, but we're still trying to keep everybody safe. And if you don't want to light the candle, that's fine. We will, if nobody comes up, and there are a number of people that weren't able to be here tonight, then we will light the candle on their behalf or on your behalf. So let's pray. Lord, you know that sometimes we find it hard to let go of our loved ones and leave them in your keeping. And so we thank you for the light of your love, proclaimed in Jesus Christ and symbolised in our Easter candle here. As we light each small candle from it, we offer to you the memories of those we think of tonight. Help us, as we do so, to let go and to leave them safe in your care. Here is now, O merciful Father, as we remember in love those who have been placed into your hands. Knowledge we pray, sheep of your own fold, enfold them in the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and in the glorious company of the saints of light. Amen. I'm going to begin by lighting the first candle for all those who have died of COVID-19.
So we remember tonight Anne Allinson, Melvin Armitage and Lily Armitage. Brenda Atkinson, Stuart Axel, Sylvia Bottomley, Joan Brighton, and Dennis Vernon. Sylvia Connell. Keith Davis, Matt Dickinson, Judith Evans Tony Fisher Margaret Forrest and Ronald Forrest Sandra Dodley
We light another candle for all those who have died during this pandemic.
Andrea Howells, Dave Hughes, Robin Irving. John Richards. Stringer Gary Tomlinson. Jeffrey Walton.
And we'd like to candle for all those who have no one remembering them tonight, but they are known by God.
Bernard Walk and Mabel Walk. Mary Webb. Judith Woodhead. Dorothy Riley and Olive Templeman. Edward Cox, Dorothy Cox, Edward Guy Cox, Alan Pickersgill and Eileen, Alan Pickersgill. Eileen Thornton. Marion Davis. Joseph Garnett. jack toes and salad toes.
Lord, now lettest thou my servant depart in peace, according to my word. For my eyes have seen the salvation which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and to be the glory of my people Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let us pray. Lovely God, as we wrestle now with our grief, we are reminded of all who have lost loved ones, whose lives have been touched by tragedy and are overwhelmed by sorrow. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Pray for them in their shock, hurt and bewilderment. We lift before you their sense of desolation and despair, their feelings of numbness and emptiness, the aching hearts which see just a blank void where so much joy used to be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for each one of us here today. Reach out and encircle us in your loving arms. Grant us the comfort you have promised to all those who mourn, your peace that passes understanding, your light that reaches into the darkest places of life and beyond into the darkness of death. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Within your heart, may the hope of the gospel, the experience of your love, the support of family and friends bring the help that is needed at this time, the strength to endure sorrow in all its intensity, and to face death in all its apparent finality, yet ultimately to look forward in faith, knowing that in Christ nothing can finally separate us from you or from those whom we love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So we stand to sing our final hymn. Thank
perfect in all your ways. May the Spirit bring you healing and peace. And may the blessing of God, the Holy Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, drive all darkness from you and pour upon you blessing and light, now and always.
Amen.
God bless you with comforting.